Hello. In this presentation, I will illustrate the characteristics of the European Space Agency Next Generation Radiation Monitors and their possible optimization for LISA. I will illustrate why it's so important to fly particle detectors on board space interferometers to monitor the dense mass charging, and lessons learned with LISA Pathfinder when we compared Monte Carlo simulations of the dense mass charging carried out before the mission was sent to orbit with in-orbit measurements. I will also compare the characteristics of the particle detectors flown on board LISA Pathfinder, ESA and GEM in terms of detection and monitoring of solar particles and galactic cosmic rays. Finally, I will deserve just a few words to stress as LISA will give a great contribution to space weather science investigations. The particle detectors on board space interferometers are aimed to monitor the overall particle flux of galactic and solar origin in order to sample the energy distribution of these particles, because the test mass charging depends on the energy distribution of incident particles. In particular, the solar energetic particle events are much more, the flux of solar energetic particles are much more populated at low energies, and while cosmic rays are characterized by energy spectra with the spectral index less steep than those of solar particles. In this sense, it is important that particle detectors on both space interferometers are able to monitor both solar and galactic cosmic rays. Before LISA Pathfinder was sent to orbit, we carried out Monte Carlo simulations of the test mass charging, predicting the galactic cosmic ray flux at the time the mission was supposed to send into orbit, and also estimated the number of solar energetic particle events and intensities. Of course, these predictions can be made on average. It's not possible to say exactly when a solar particle event of a given intensity will occur, or when the galactic cosmic ray flux will fluctuate due to the passage of interplanetary structures or of high-speed solar wind streams. To carry out reliable predictions of test mass charging, we also needed detailed information of space core geometry materials, and was necessary to adopt good tools for high energy particle simulation and transportation in matter, like GM4 and Fluca. In particular, we adopted Fluca. The average predictions of galactic cosmic rays and solar energetic particle event occurrence can be made on the basis of the trend of the solar activity. LISA Pathfinder was in orbit between 2016 and 2017 during the declining phase of the solar cycle 24, the weakest of the last 100 years. Here is reported the sunspot number, which is the most widely used proxy for the solar activity. LISA Pathfinder flew under this condition solar activity during a global solar magnetic field positive polarity, which is found when the lines of the magnetic field of the Sun exit from the North Pole. Under these conditions, galactic cosmic rays propagated in the solar wind undergo convection and diffusion, but not drift. LISA Pathfinder and LISA are supposed to fly, at least for LISA, for the majority of time, during similar conditions of the global solar magnetic field and during a very weak solar cycle, even weaker than the 24. All the predictions for the two next solar cycles foresee two very weak cycles with a high flux of galactic cosmic rays and very few events of solar energetic particles. However, these are, as I said, average predictions. So in any case, we need to fly particle detectors that are able to monitor possibly in advance solar energetic particles and galactic cosmic ray variations. With respect to predictions, in this figure I have reported minimum and maximum predictions for both proton and helium that were carried out for LISA Pathfinder before the mission was sent to space. And since the observations between the end of 2015 and beginning 2016 were pretty much in the middle of these predictions, once we establish a range for the test mass charging, we were expecting something in the middle. The net charge is calculated by considering positive and negative particles with positive particles and negative that must be subtracted, while for the effective charging they must be summed up. And the results were that we were expecting, given the observed solar activity, 23 charges per second for the net charging. And actually, we observed something very, very close during the first part of the mission. These data were gathered in the spring 2016. While there was not the case for the effective charging, the result to be the calculated one was 3-4 times smaller than observations. If the problem was ascribable to cosmic ray predictions, and this was not the case because after the mission we compared our predictions to the measurements of the MS-02 data gathered on the space station, and we observed an agreement within 10%. But I mean, if the problem was connected with the galactic cosmic rays, we had to find a similar problem for the net and effective test mass charging. So investigations on this topic were carried out, and see the talk by Mattia Villani for details. So we were very happy with our average predictions of galactic cosmic rays. We didn't observe any solar event accelerating particles above the galactic cosmic ray background. So we had the possibility to monitor the galactic cosmic ray flux all over the mission with our particle detector very nicely, as you will see. Our particle detector consisted of two silicon wafers of 1.4 times 1.05 centimeter square area, placed in a telescopic arrangement at 2 centimeter distance, and placed within inside a copper box that was stopping particles, ions in particular, with energy smaller than 70 MeV per nucleon. In this case, we had quite precise monitoring of particles reaching the test masses above 100 MeV per nucleon. We were able to count up to 6,500 counts per second, we would be able to store up to 5,000 energy deposits per second. We didn't actually need this kind of performance because, as I said, we just observed galactic cosmic rays. These are the observations, and data were gathered every 15 seconds and binned in 1 hour. We had an uncertainty of just 1%. That's why we had the possibility to observe these nice variations and fluctuations of cosmic rays. 45 recurrent depressions with duration larger than 2 days. Associated with the solar rotation and high-speed streams from coronal holes. We observed also 23 non-recurrent variations of duration smaller than 2 days. These ones were associated with the passage through the heliospheric garnish sheets, and we observed also 3 Forbush decreases. In order to go into details, in the left figure you can follow the recurrent variations. The average duration of the recurrent variation was 9 days. In the green oval you see one of them, while in the red circles there are two short non-recurrent variations, one associated with the heliospheric Arecibo crossing, the deep, while the peaks, just a few during the mission, were found when cosmic rays were confined in this compressed plasma of the solar wind between two closely spaced high-speed streams. In the right figure, it's reported to Forbush decreases. Unfortunately, these sudden drops of the galactic cosmic ray flux associated with the passage of interplanetary counterparts or coronal mass ejection cannot be studied with data gathered on Earth, mainly for these low intensity events. So it is very, very important to fly particle detectors that can trace these peculiar non-recurrent variations of galactic cosmic rays. I have no time to go into details of the physics behind this process. So for this topic, please follow the talk by Simone Benella. The ESA and GRM are consisting of two separate units. They are one is meant for proton detection and is able to measure the differential flux of protons between 2 and 200 MeV. But unfortunately, for higher energy particles, the geometric factor is not good at all. It's very small compared to ours. To those flown on LISA Pathfinder, a few orders of magnitude smaller, and therefore we have the possibility to make a good monitoring of solar energy particles, prediction also of SCP occurrence, but unfortunately no variations of galactic cosmic ray flux monitoring will be allowed. This figure illustrates why this is the case. When you measure solar energy particles, the flux is very high and the energy spectra are very steep. So if you measure particles in this energy range, you will know what is going on for the rest of the energies. But unfortunately, this is not the case for galactic cosmic rays, because 200 MeV is just not enough to cover the trend of the overall energy spectrum. The electron unit of the NGRM will allow to measure solar electrons, and this is very good because the intensity of solar electrons in this energy range corresponds to that of protons in the interval 50-100 MeV. So while NGRM is very, very good for SCP short-term prediction and monitoring, this is not the case for galactic cosmic ray flux variations. So the addition of a third unit with a geometrical factor ranging between 20 and 50 centimeters squared steradians, just one pin diode of 2.8 times 2.8 centimeter square area would do the job, and by placing the viewing axis of this third unit perpendicular to the Parker spiral of the interplanetary magnetic field and the NGRM in the direction of the Parker spiral. LISA will carry out the first measurements of SCPs within 1 degree in longitude and will be a natural sentinel for SCP events observed on Earth before they reach our planet, with or without the Lagrange mission in L1. That would be even better. So I thank you very much for the attention. Our recommendation is to fly the NGRM for solar particles and one other small unit for galactic cosmic rays. And I'll wait for your questions and comments, and thank you very much for the attention.